Thank you, Nancy. My microphone's falling apart. There we go. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship on this beautiful sunny day. It's a little chilly out there today, but boy, are the colors incredible. Does anyone have any announcements you need to or would like to share with the congregations? Oh, 2 cents a meal Sunday? Oh, right. Yes, next Sunday we set the clocks back. You get an extra hour. You can show up at the regular time if you want to, but, you know, just, you know, turn on the heat and make the coffee.
Do we need to set a date for session?
Yes. I am covering for David for worship next week, so I'm going to have to boogie out of here really quickly next Sunday. So, but the Sunday after, should we meet and talk about what we're going to do about winter months and high fuel costs and how we might get around that with Zoom worship and that sort of thing? So maybe would that be the 13th? Spend a little extra time in worship on the 13th. Is that good for everybody? Okay. 2 weeks from today. Yeah. Just don't fall down. Okay. All right. Well, this is going to be fun today. Okay. Not touching it anymore. Well, let us begin our time of worship together with the call to worship in the bulletin. This is from Psalm 149. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy. Praise the Lord. Let us worship God. Let us pray together. Almighty God, through generations, you have knit together your people to be the body of your Son, Christ our Lord. Give us grace to follow your blessed saints in their virtuous living, that we may come to know the joys that you have prepared for those who truly love you. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is number 109.
Thank you.
Tuesday is All Saints Day, and so today we are going to be considering that as part of our worship service. So for today, we have a litany for All Saints. I would invite you to join me as we read responsibly this litany. Today we remember teachers and storytellers who made God's stories come alive for us. We give you thanks, O God. We remember choir members, praise bands, organists, and all the musicians who sang and played your praises. We rejoice in their memory, O God. We remember preachers and lay leaders who have led our worship through the years. We thank you for their testimony, O God. We remember parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, sisters, and brothers who sat with us on Sundays and lived out their faith all week long. We remember all those who have been a part of this faith family. We are so grateful for them, O God. They have finished their work on earth, and through us it lives on. May it continue to bear fruit. Our lives are full of mistakes and errors, places where we follow self-generated idols instead of the one true God. We are not alone in these mistakes. All of those who have come before us were also plagued with temptation and sin. So let us come before God, just as generations of believers have done, and pray for God's forgiveness and grace. Let us pray. Beloved God, who knew our mothers and fathers, and even to our spiritual forebears, have mercy on us. We do not always love as you would have us love. We do not always do as you would have us do. We turn from you when we should turn to you. Lord, do not let us go. Hold us close, so we may know you as our ancestors did. We praise you for the grace you shower on us, constantly forgiving our errors, especially the ones that we don't share with anyone but you. Hear now the silent fears and worries of our hearts. Friends, hear the good news. Though our ancestors did not follow God's ways perfectly, we have hope in the one who did, Jesus of Nazareth. Through his death and resurrection, he shows us God has already forgiven us. Therefore, we and all who have come before us are rightly known as saints, the holy ones of God. Thanks be to God for God's mercy, grace, and love. Amen. Okay, some of our joys and concerns from last week. Chris heard from her friend Sue, who is out of isolation on the cruise ship and enjoying her time in Morocco. And George got good work or good report on his blood work regarding his multiple myeloma. That's great. Also having a lot of fun with the boys. We were continuing to pray for John's brother Dale, who's struggling with his back. He's planning on having some specialized treatment to deal with that in the coming weeks. Prayers for drought conditions throughout the world and the hunger that is associated with that and all of the disruptions. And just prayers for peace in our world. I was already jotting down some things. I've got a rather long list myself for things to pray for this week. Prayers for the folks in Seoul, Korea, who the families of the victims, of the people who were crushed in that slow-moving stampede. Political violence in our country. Prayers for folks who are perpetrating it and the victims of it. Drought conditions that are continuing. And more personal prayer concerns. Brenda Herndon, those of you who know Brenda Herndon, she's having surgery tomorrow. Yes, tomorrow, on her neck, the arteries. Travel mercies for my husband, who is going to Little Rock on Tuesday for a week of continuing education. And Robert and Ambrin are also heading back to France on Tuesday. And a prayer of thanksgiving for Mary Lee's 80th birthday, which will actually be this coming Friday, but we celebrated it at the house yesterday with some neighbors and some family. So, are there any other joys or concerns anyone would like to share today? Okay, so she's... So communication is stopped, not sure why.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's concerning.
But she's got, you know, she has family here that look after her very carefully.
Yeah, okay. Okay. Anything else or anyone else? Yeah, Linda.
For Becky, she's in the hospital again. She went back in on Wednesday. We welcome Maddox.
Yay!
On October the 20th, he went past the day the doctor said.
Well, of course he did.
4:58 a.m., 7 pounds, 7 ounces, 21 and a quarter inches long.
Yay!
Came home from the hospital in a pumpkin outfit. And for all the troubles in our world, everything that's going on all around, for the last couple weeks, we have really experienced the beauty of the nature around us, and it kind of brought touching to my heart for all the troubles in the world to see the leaves and all the beauty here right now.
Yeah, it has been. It has been. Yes. Thank you, Linda. That's a wonderful reminder.
It was fun seeing Robert and the old boy. Robert, they came out to visit.
Oh!
I hadn't seen him in a while.
So yay! Good. So Thanksgiving for reunions and for time away. Anything else? Anyone else? All righty. Those of you who are joining us on Facebook Live, if you have anything you would like to contribute to that, just mention it in the comments and I will bring it in when we get to our prayers. Meanwhile, if you will join me in the prayer for illumination, that is printed in the bulletin. Let us pray together. Holy Spirit, come to this place and bless us with your wisdom, that we might be guided by this living word and molded by its message. Amen. Well, if we had been going along the way that we had been going along in Luke's gospel, today would have been the story about Zacchaeus. I'm pushing that off a week. We're going to do Zacchaeus next week. This week, I thought, wouldn't it be interesting to incorporate All Saints Day into our worship service. I don't know that I've ever done that before. All Saints Day is usually celebrated on the first day of November, and I'll get to a little history about All Saints Day in a little while. But the scripture lesson that has been selected, or the gospel lesson selected for All Saints Day this particular liturgical year, is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 6, verses 20 through 37. And if you think, wow, that sounds kind of familiar, it's probably because you've heard it before, for one thing, and also because it was the gospel lesson for February 20th, 2022. So we did already do this one. I actually have a different sermon for it, believe it or not. This is called the Sermon on the Plain. Then Jesus turned to his disciples and said, God blesses you who are poor, for the kingdom of God is yours. God blesses you who are hungry now, for you will be satisfied. God blesses you who weep now, for in due time you will laugh. What blessings await you when people hate you and exclude you and mock you and curse you as evil because you follow the Son of Man? When that happens, be happy. Yes, leap for joy, for a great reward awaits you in heaven. And remember, their ancestors treated the ancient prophets the same way. What sorrow awaits you who are rich, for you have only your happiness now. What sorrow awaits you who are fat and prosperous now, for a time of awful hunger awaits you. What sorrow awaits you who laugh now, for your laughing will turn to mourning and sorrow. What sorrow awaits you who are praised by the crowds, for their ancestors also praised false prophets. But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on one cheek, offer the other cheek also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt. Give to anyone who asks, and when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. If you love only those who love you, why should you get credit for that? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get credit? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get credit? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High, for He is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn others, or it will all come back against you. Forgive others, and you will be forgiven. This is the word of the Lord, and thanks be to God. Well, I've known since I've been doing this church gig, actually probably since I was a kid, that All Saints Day is usually celebrated around Halloween. As a matter of fact, Halloween is an offshoot of All Saints Day. All Saints Day is kind of migrated hither and yon throughout the calendar and throughout the world. The most pinpoint historical time for the celebration of All Saints Day in the church comes from 13 May in either 609 or 610, they're not really sure, established by Pope Boniface IV. that's the most, in church history, that's where they can pinpoint it most closely, as this is the day. It had been celebrated prior to that, particularly among the very first Christians, the very first churches that were in Asia Minor, celebrating the martyrdom of the folks, people who lost their lives for following after the way of Jesus. So it kind of, since the beginning of the Jesus movement, there has been time where people recognize the people in their faith groups who have passed away. It's morphed over the years, and since the church established it way back in 610 or 69, they're not sure which, it has been mostly a way of remembering the people in faith who have gone before us, particularly those who helped establish the faith in us, planted the seeds, nurtured the growth, and helped us harvest the fruit of our faith. Like I said, it kind of travels throughout. It was established in May by Pope Boniface, but it has since morphed and come around the calendar to land on the 1st of November. And they did that mostly because the church has a history of establishing its feast days in place of pagan festivals. Christmas is set around the time, I think it's of Saturnalia, or of the worship of the light coming back into the world after the winter solstice. So Christmas kind of took over that one. Easter is with Passover and also some pagan festivals of springtime. And I can never say it right, Samhain, I think, is the pagan festival that remembers the dead, which is the Wiccan celebration that is Halloween. So All Saints Day is established on the 1st of November, and pagans and folks who are outside the faith said, we'll get you, and so Halloween is kind of a Mardi Gras for All Saints Day. It's an opportunity to dress up and scare the pants off of each other before remembering the people who have died. All Saints Day is an inherited practice. It's something that has come to us from the earliest time of our life as a church together. And at this time of year anyway, we start turning our attention to holiday customs within our own homes and within our culture. How many of you have seen anything Christmassy yet in the stores? I have not, because I don't go. But I was noticing somebody posted a picture on social media of a Walmart that had Halloween on this side and Christmas on that side of the same store. It's like, can we just have one at a time? So think about what are the types of things that you begin hauling out of closets or the attic, the things that you start putting in your home or surrounding yourself with to prepare yourself for this time of year. And those things that you pull out of storage, who is attached to them? Did someone give you that? Did you inherit that from an ancestor? And if it is something that you inherited from somebody who was gone on, would you consider that person a saint? And why or why not? A saint is defined as a person who is acknowledged as holy or virtuous and typically regarded as being in heaven after death. But a saint, more colloquially, is a very virtuous, kind, or patient person. And when we talk among ourselves about people we know, oh, that person is a saint, that's usually what we mean when we say that. Somebody who has just been so warm and generous and giving and patient. I have a person in my own history. I cannot remember her last name. Her first name was Sally. And I think of her as a saint, because she was a very patient and giving person. She was the vice principal at my high school. And when I was a senior in high school, I was stretched so thin. I was in AP classes, I was in band, I was in choir, I was a student body president, I was the president of the speech club, I was involved in my church. I was just, I was about to snap and things were starting to fray. And another teacher who was close to me noticed that. And so she set up a time for me to go talk with Sally X name, I sure wish I could remember her name, who was the vice principal at the school. And I think this person, I think she had some training in counseling. Because when I came into the office, she greeted me. She did not, I got no judgmental vibes from her. I got no, you should be doing this kind of things from her. What I got from her was, what's going on, Molly? What's happening in your life? And so I told her. And I told her all the things I was involved in and how it was just, I felt like I had no time for me. And she said, Molly, I want to tell you something that I wish somebody had told me when I was your age. You don't have to do it all. And so after this conversation, I went home after school and I thought about all the things I was involved in and I dropped some stuff. And I came back together. So I remember her compassion and her non-judgmental attitude and her desire to help somebody who was coming apart. Can you think of someone in your own life who saw you struggling like that and offered a similar way of compassion? That person is your saint. The Luke passage today, which is designated for All Saints Sunday, has Jesus giving the Sermon on the Plain. Now, you might have noticed from what I read, the things before, that sounded a lot like the Sermon on the Mount, which is in Matthew's gospel. Now, Matthew and Luke have very different understandings of Jesus and what they wanted people to understand about Jesus. Matthew wanted people to understand that Jesus was the new Moses. And so, of course, Jesus was on the mountain, reinterpreting the Ten Commandments. But for Luke, Jesus was for everyone. And so Luke had Jesus come down off the mountain and be all on the same level with the people gathered around him. And that is a Christological stance of Jesus being in and among the people, which is why I think All Saints Day is probably an important thing for us to remember, because those saints, those people that we might hold in high regard, are also human beings for whom Jesus came. Speaking of this particular passage in Luke, David Loos in his blog In the Meantime says, the crowds came to Jesus to listen. They also came to have their illnesses cured, demons cast out, and needs met from his abundant power. The people who came were vulnerable in the extreme, and Jesus knew that. Jesus came down into their midst to talk to them and meet them in their vulnerability and in their need. And he offered them blessings, similar to the blessings in Matthew's gospel. Blessed are the poor, blessed are the hungry. Blessed are you when you were cursed because of me. But he added some things in Luke's gospel. Luke has some woes, or alas, alas for you. Alas if you're rich now, and that's what you're enjoying now, because that's what's happening for you now. And if we find ourselves centered in the things that we have, the riches that we have, the blessings that we have, the privilege that we have, that's all we have. That's it. And for some people in our world and some people in our society, that may seem really okay. They've got big houses, they've got a lot of money, they have a lot of prestige. But is that really okay? Because it sets up barriers. The rich, the 1%, as Bernie Sanders would say, the wealthy, with their security, keeping themselves away from us, and they can't take it with them. When they die, they die. And everything that's left, yeah, it'll get fought over. So when Jesus gets, so when we get to verse 27, when Jesus says, I say to those of you who are willing to listen, Rolf Jacobson one time said, maybe it's better interpreted to say, to those of you who are still listening. Because you got to imagine, by that point, after Jesus offered the woes to the people who were centered in their lives now, probably a lot of people walked off. Oh, that guy. And they went away. I don't want to hear this socialist stuff. So he says to them, I declare to you who are still listening. And then he starts talking about loving our enemies. It's like when our parents sat us down at one point in time in our lives for the talk, a come to Jesus time. Did we check out of that conversation? When we were confronted with our own stubbornness, when we wanted to hold on to our own way, but our parents sat down and said, listen. This is what Jesus is doing now. Listen. To those of you who are still listening, they're given instruction about how to live as Jesus followers. And in this world, live with vulnerability. Someone slaps you on the cheek, you offer them the other one. And an interesting thing about that one, in that world, you did everything with this hand. So if somebody slapped you on the face with this hand, and you offered them the other one, they had to backhand, or they would ordinarily they would backhand you, which is what people would do to subordinates, or children, or slaves. It established a hierarchy. But if you offered the other one, say, okay, you hit me on this one, do this one, then you have to come this way, and it establishes you as equals. Because you have a chance to block it, or say, all right, come at me. It makes the person who is acting superior consider their relationship with you. This is a human being standing in front of me that I just backhanded. Can I treat them as an equal? Taking your stuff, Jesus says, let them have it. These things challenge us, both the people who were taking and the people who were being taken from, to see the inherent humanity and dignity in one another. Because if someone comes and takes something from you and you react, it's establishing a confrontational relationship. But if someone takes something and you say, oh, here, you missed this, what does that do to them? It points them out for what they have done. You're probably not going to get your stuff back, but it's just stuff. We tend to resist these teachings from Jesus because vulnerability, living vulnerably, allowing someone to hit us, allowing someone to take our things, means there are no barriers. There are no barriers. We are not erecting barriers between us and other people. And in our world today, how do we live like that in a culture where there are tons of grudges and violence that comes out of those grudges? What it does is it teaches us an ultimate reliance on God and God's provision. Jesus lived like that. Jesus erected no barriers between himself and anyone, and it mapped a path to the cross, to the grave, and then to resurrection, where we get the power to live like him. Bill Loder says that Jesus is not leading people into a fantasy that no danger exists. This is eyes open instruction. People will hate you. Don't hate in response. And so he continues on, Jesus continues on instructing, and verse 37, the last one that I read, forgive as you have been forgiven. I was going through Bible Gateway, looking at all the different translations of this particular passage, just seeing how people would choose to interpret different Greek words in the language, and I got to the Orthodox Jewish Bible, and this is fascinating. And I'm going to share this with you because I thought it was awesome. The Orthodox Jewish Bible for verse 37 says, "Judge not, lest you be judged, and do not condemn, and by no means may you be condemned. If you pardon with mechila, forgiveness, you will be pardoned with selicha, forgiveness." So I went to the Greek and I looked, it's the same word, forgiveness, forgiveness. And in English, it's the same word, forgiveness, forgiveness. But in Hebrew, it's two different words. Selicha, with which we will be pardoned if we forgive, is personal forgiveness, granted so that a transgression will not permanently blight a relationship. Ooh, I did that thing, and the person says, it's okay. Smooths over the mess, cleans up the mess, and you continue on together. Mechila is an objective pardon, a waiver of punishment, which the transgressor should have deserved. An example is if I throw a pie at you, I owe you two things. Compensation for your dry cleaning, for getting the mess cleaned up, and an apology for the psychological insult that I inflicted. They share a root word that means erase, blot out, remove. And notice the order that the Orthodox Jewish Bible puts them in. You waive, you relinquish punishment. You turn the other cheek, you hand over your shirt. And then you are forgiven. And you enter into an open space, a place of emptiness that can be filled by the grace and mercy of God. So with all of that in mind, think back again. Who is your saint? Who are the people who practice this kind of forgiveness and gave you this faithful inheritance? Who are the people that were not doormats, but when someone did something wrong to them, they said, this is what happened. And then allowed the relationship to move on beyond that. I thought of somebody, my own dad. When I was after my first year in college, I was working at the same place that Dad was working, the Manville Corporation down in King Carroll Ranch, south of Denver. And we had to get up really early because Dad carpooled with somebody else who worked down there in the legal department. Her name was Charlotte, and she needed to be there at a certain time. And my father, being a pretty punctual guy, was always out of the house about 5 o'clock, 5:30. I don't remember. It was always dark. And I needed to be out of the house with him. And one particular day, it was Charlotte's turn to drive. One particular day, I had a hard time getting up and getting out of bed. And we wound up being about close to 10 minutes late getting over to Charlotte's house, which meant she was going to be about 10 minutes late getting to work, which was not good for her. And so as we piled into her car, she looked over at my father and said, I don't appreciate being late. Can you be sure that you don't do that again? And my father, who by all rights should have turned around and looked at me in the back seat and said, yeah, instead just said, I understand, it won't happen again. And it didn't. Because my dad took Charlotte's wrath and did not throw me under the bus. So who are the people in your lives who have given you a faithful inheritance? They are the people for whom their faith was crucial, and it was a big part of their identity. And we can only do the Lord's work if we understand that we are the Lord's people. We can only be the hands of Christ in this world as long as we understand the hands that were pierced by nails for us. Our identity is in the Lord Jesus. We're God's people, created and called to follow the one who first loved and redeemed us. Our individual and our family stories are bound up with the old story of God. Our story goes through Galilee, to Jerusalem, to the Passover, goes to suffer and die on the cross, and our story is part of that empty tomb. The Sermon on the Plain can be lived out by us because of God's love and mercy for us, shown to the people who came before, shown to us by them. We can love our enemies, not just our friends, do good to those who hate us, bless those who curse us, pray for those who abuse us, who hurt us. We can give and keep on giving, love and keep on loving, and have mercy without expectation of return or reward. We do it because it is what we have inherited. And most importantly, we can forgive. We can receive the blessing of our faithful inheritance and understand the people who gave them as individuals, loved and forgiven by God through Jesus Christ, just as we are. Thanks be to God for the gift of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to set us free. Amen. Let us sing together our second hymn, number 2, It Is Well With My Soul.
Thank you.
There's a real story behind that hymn, too. I love it. People of God, let us remember that as we pray, we kneel alongside Jesus Christ in the presence of God and with the help of the Holy Spirit. Let us come before our God's throne of grace in humility and with the full assurance that God hears us. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we give you thanks and we give you praise for this day that you have made. We give you thanks and we give you praise for this place that you have provided, for this time that you have provided. And we give you thanks and we give you praise for brothers and sisters surrounding us, not only here in this place, but online and in your realm. The people who have come before us, who have blessed us with their faith. In every age, you have raised up men and women, people to reflect the light of Jesus Christ and to teach us to follow after his way, your way. So we thank you for those who have been shepherds of your people. We give you thanks for all of the saints who have worshiped you, whether it's been under trees or in cathedrals, whether it has been in weather-beaten wooden churches or crumbling cement meeting houses or in secret. Where your name has been glorified and adored, we give you thanks, O God, for hands lifted in praise. And we thank you for those hands that we have known, hands that have been manicured, hands that have been stained with grease or dirt, hands that are strong from work, and those that have been gnarled with age. Hands lifted in the holy work of your people as an offering across the landscape of our memories. We thank you, Almighty God, for these saints who worked hard. Wearing hard hats or steel boots or blue collars or three-piece suits, those who made homes with their efforts and with their love. They left their mark on the earth for the sake of your name and for us and for those yet to come. We thank you, Almighty God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by those who have gone before us. Bless the memories of your saints. May we learn how to walk wisely from their examples of faith, dedication, worship, and love. Through the example of their faith, especially as it was expressed in their prayers, we bring to you the needs of those whose lives are closely linked with our own and the lives of people that are known only to you. We pray for the folks who are grieving loved ones who were crushed in the Halloween gathering in Seoul. And we pray for people around the globe who are missing loved ones, either because of natural disasters or war. There are so many. And so we lift them before you because you know who they are and you promise to comfort them. And if it is within our possibility to help in any way, make that known to us. We pray for our own country and the political violence that is in the world. We pray for the people who perpetuate hatred and stereotypes for political gain, for monetary gain. We pray for these people who hurt us. And we pray that you will surround them. Do what you will, but surround them. And for the people that we know, we pray for Brenda and her surgery tomorrow. We pray that you will be with her doctors, her nurses, the whole surgical team, and with her family. We pray that you will be with David as he heads to Little Rock on Tuesday, and that you will be with Robert and Ambrin as they go home to France on Tuesday. Give all of them safe travels. Get them safely to where they are going. We thank you for people that we know and love who are celebrating years. Mary Lee on Friday, and the people that we know whose birthdays are coming up. And we pray that you will be with Chris's friend, Chris, and that communication will be reestablished. We pray for Becky, who is once again in the hospital. Excuse me. And we are so grateful that Maddox is here. Yay! Bless that little boy and bless his parents. We are grateful for reunions and for time away and thankful for the beauty of this your world. And how when we start feeling so full of despair and don't know where to turn, we can look out of our windows and see what you have made and be reassured you've not forgotten us. We thank you for the gift of music and for the way that it reminds us of people we know and love and what they were to us. For the people that we have prayed for, Almighty God, heal them in mind, in body, in circumstance. Work in them and through them by your grace, wonders beyond all they may dream or even hope. And we also lift up to you that those who live deep within our hearts and those worries and concerns, that find a home in there. And so in this time of silence, we open our hearts to you and offer you the deepest part of ourselves. Loving God, we, your saints, gather to worship and praise you today. We celebrate the saints who have served you and been example for us through the past. We give you thanks for the joy of being a part of the communion of saints with those who have gone before and those who are scattered around the globe. Open us to your spirit to continue being the saints you have called us to be. We pray these things in the name of the most gracious Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to say these words together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In Christ, we have obtained an everlasting inheritance. As an act of praise and thanksgiving, joining with the acts of so many who have gone before us, let us share this inheritance with and through the body of Jesus Christ. Let us worship God with our gifts and our lives. Pray together. We give you thanks, O Lord, with all our heart. You have provided everything we need in your steadfast love. Receive these offerings as our response to your great faithfulness, for the praise of Jesus' name. Amen. And our final hymn is number 345.
Counsels guide our path.
And now, my friends, go out into this world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what's good. Return no one evil for evil, but strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Rejoice and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power that the Holy Spirit gives you to do those things, and so very, very much more. And now may the love of the God who created you, the peace of the God who redeemed you, and the strength of the God who sustains you be with you now, this day, and always. Go with God, my friends. Go in peace. Amen. Please greet one another with the words of the ancient church. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.